I would now like to call this regular meeting of the Board of Education to order at 7:20 p.m. I apologize for the board running late on our closed session. We'll now take a moment of silence, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Ask the board members to remember to speak into your microphones, and at this time, I will have the coordinator take the roll.
Ms. Jackson?
Present.
Mr. Rollins?
Here.
Mr. Scrivano?
Here.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Here.
Dr. Harner?
Here.
Mr. Connor?
Here.
Mrs. Powers?
Here.
With seven present, we have a quorum.
We have no media students here tonight, but is Vince around? I saw him. Vince, could you step out for a second? There he is. This is Vince's last board meeting with us, and he has been a great asset to the board. We've complained long and hard about AV things for back on the Madison Street days or whatever, and this guy has taken care of every need that we've ever asked him for. So we wish him luck in his new job and his new career, and thanks for all you've done for RPS 205.
Thank you.
Now we'd like to recognize and celebrate outstanding contributions of our students and staff. And Mr. Dotson.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, and good evening. Channel 13 WREX has recently recognized a Rockford Public Schools teacher with their Teacher of the Week Award. Maud Johnson Elementary School teacher, Miss Julia Johnson, was recognized earlier this month as a 13 WREX Teacher of the Week. The student who nominated Miss Johnson gave WREX this message for his second grade teacher. You're the best teacher ever! Johnson focuses on reading and writing, particularly creative writing. She loves being able to help her students do their best in her classroom and be their best in life. They enjoy being here, and I want that for them, she told WREX. Thank you, Mrs. Johnson, for all you do for your students and for Rockford Public Schools.
I gotta get a hug. I don't.
Okay. I would also like to mention that her principal, Amber Miller, is also with us this evening. Hello, Amber. And she also has two of her colleagues who are here with her as well. Great support there.
All right.
Thank you, sir. That is all.
And I can personally attest to the greatness of this teacher. Because she had my granddaughter last year, and she still interacts with my granddaughter. So I have two proclamations to read tonight. The first one is Financial Aid Awareness Month. Whereas the city of Rockford has only 19% of its population with at least a bachelor's degree, while the nation has at least 37.8%, according to the U.S. Census, and Illinois has 42.7%. And whereas companies move to and stay where there is an educated workforce, whereas the Rockford Public Schools has a readiness rock of preparing all students in the area of career and college readiness, and whereas many graduating high school seniors will not pursue college or career preparation training because of financial reasons, whereas the Rockford Public Schools has a goal of college for all, And whereas only 49% of graduating high school seniors applied for federal or state aid for college or technical training in 2013, and whereas the latest return on investment study from NIU indicates that for every dollar invested in post-secondary education for Rockford High School students who would not otherwise go to college generates for the community $131 in jobs, local expenditures, and savings in social programs and incarceration. Therefore, the Rockford Board of Education proclaims the month of February as Financial Aid Awareness Month. During this month, workshops will be held for students and parents on how to complete the free application for federal student aid, as well as other scholarship applications. Many agencies and organizations, including the Rockford Public Schools, Rockford Promise, Illinois Student Assistance Commission, Rock Valley College, Rockford University, the Rockford Public Library, and Community Foundation of Northern Illinois, have all come together to offer parents and students in this community numerous opportunities to learn about how to finance college, as well as other post-secondary education opportunities. We, the board, approve this and sign this on the 28th day of January, 2014. We also have a proclamation for Black History Month. Whereas Black History Month began as a Negro History Week in 1926 by African-American scholar Dr. Carter G. Woodson during the second week of February to coincide with the birthdays of Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. Whereas the observance was expanded to a month-long celebration in 1976 and has been recognized by every U.S. president since. And whereas during Black History Month, Americans celebrates the culture, traditions, and important events of those who trace their roots back to Africa. Whereas according to the U.S. Census Bureau, an estimated 42 million African Americans live in the United States, constituting 13.6% of the country's total population. Whereas through our nation's history, African Americans have enriched our culture and brought creativity and innovation to everything from sports to the sciences and from the arts to the economy. Whereas people of African American descent have served with valor in every military conflict since the Revolutionary War. And whereas for the first time in the nation's history, the President of the United States is of African American descent. Now, therefore, let it be known that the Rockford Board of Education, Superintendent of Schools, and Administration do hereby recognize Black History Month, signed this 28th day of January, 2014. Thank you. I don't see any cards for public speakers, are there any? No, okay. So we'll skip the petitions and communications, and we are now at the agenda item for board member comments. Mr. Connor.
Couple good news items. Number one, for those of you that did not see it, the All City Art Exhibit is still going on. Anybody who's interested, I have the five examples of artwork from each of the high schools, and these can be ordered, and they're very good, and it gives the name of the students on the front and their artwork. So it was great work, and for those students, congratulations. It was a great effort. Second is, on the athletic side, if I have my numbers correct, the Auburn boys basketball is number one, Auburn girls basketball is number two.
Woo!
on the East High side, the boys basketball just had their 1,000th win. So,
woo!
Again, congratulations to all. Thank you.
Mrs. Powers.
I won't hoot and holler. Two things. One, Vince not only served this board, but he also served our students. He was a coach, soccer coach over at Jefferson. So I really hope that his new position will allow him to still interface with our kids because he was really great with them. So I wanted to make sure you knew the level of service that he provided to this district. Secondly, at the last board meeting, I asked for the schedule for the revisions to the student code of conduct, and I received that. It's on our website. Out on the table, there's a little slip with the schedule if anybody here wants to pick up the schedule for our code of conduct meetings. And just briefly, the next one is this Thursday, January 30th at 6 o'clock at West Middle School. And then the next one after that is February 20th, 4:30 to 5:30 at West Middle School. Thank you.
Ms. McCullough.
And I was actually going to report on that student code of conduct review that's coming up. So thank you for that interface. And that's because it will come to the education committee, which is the committee that I chair. So I wanted to make sure that everybody understood the process that we're going to be going through to review and revise that code of conduct. And it's not beginning with, because there's already been assessment and planning over the last 6 months, but it will begin, we'll begin looking at the current one in those meetings that Ms. Powers already told you. They're all on Thursdays, January 30th, February 20th and 27th, and March 6th. They're all at West Middle School. And we are complying with the law. The school code actually requires us to have those meetings and to have both parents and to have teachers there. And the REA encourages their teachers to come. And I am asking fellow board members to try to encourage parents to come, especially from each of the sub-districts, to make sure that there's representation. We would like a good cross-section of parental involvement. After those meetings occur, and by the way, there was one that was canceled due to the weather, so not surprisingly, that was the January 23rd one. So we were supposed to have five. We're doing four. Hopefully, we'll get a good turnout, because after that, there is a committee. It's called the Student Code of Conduct Review Committee, and it's primarily the professionals in the district. It's administrators, it's teachers, it's certified staff, principals, and they will review the comments from the advisory committee, which is the ones meeting at West, and they will come up with amendments to the code. And on March 10th at the education committee, they will bring that revised code to the education committee, and then it will go on April 8th to the Board of Education for the first read, and we will vote on that on April 22nd. So for everybody who wanted the process, and we need to be done by April 22nd, because then it goes to the printer so that it's available. Also, so that we can start doing some professional development with our administrators to make sure that they're all aware of any changes and that they're ready to follow that code in the following school year. So again, I spent all that time because I really do want to encourage fellow board members to participate, and it's not just parents. It's board members can participate, and hopefully that review committee is supposed to have community representatives. So if there's community representatives in terms of board member, because we do represent the community, when they put that committee together, we can let administration know. So thank you for that time.
Mr. Rollins.
Well, if I read the paper correctly this morning, the Auburn Scholastic Bowl team finished first in the Big Ten. So congratulations not only to the basketball teams, but also to the Scholastic Bowl team.
Okay. Ms. Jackson.
So I do have a question. Mrs. McCullough, do you know if that other meeting is going to be rescheduled, or you don't have information? It just will be four then?
It'll be four meetings.
Okay. So I just want to take a moment. January is School Board Appreciation Month, so I just want to say thank you. Yes, it is.
It is.
To my colleagues that volunteer your time and talents, I really enjoy working with most of you. Just kidding. I enjoy working with all of you. So I just wanted to say I appreciate you and thank you.
Well, how great. Thank you. Okay. Little tongue-in-cheek there, I think, maybe. I'm not sure. Whatever. So. All right. Dr. Harner, you're the only one that hasn't. You don't have anything. Okay. All right. Very good. All right. So we'll move on to the consent portion of our agenda item that would include our meeting minutes from January 14, 2014, payroll, accounts payable, purchase orders, contracts under $10,000, and air travel, recurring contracts of intergovernmental agreement with Rockford Park District for Camp to the Future 2, and the other consent items including the monthly investment report, financial results, interest transfer, permanent operating transfer, the 2014-15 academic calendar, and the Freedom of Information Act log. Is there a motion or a second and a second to approve the consent items?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Ms. McCullough. Are there any consent items that board members wish to have pulled for separate consideration? Ms. McCullough.
No. Yes, 9B, please.
9B, okay. I would like to pull 10B. Actually, Actually, I don't want to pull it. I just have a question. Okay. Mr. Lewis, can I ask a question on 10B? I don't really want to pull it.
Well, I have a question on it as well.
Okay.
So let's just pull it.
Let's just pull it then. Okay. So 9B and 10B are pulled. So...
And 8D, please.
8D?
Purchase orders.
Okay. So let's have a roll call for the approval of the consent items not pulled.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scribano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
Okay, I'll now take a motion to approve consent item 8D, purchase orders.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Seconded by Mr. Rollins. Any discussion or questions? Ms. Powers.
Could somebody speak to, it's a small amount, but I guess it's just the description that is throwing me off. Where is it? Matt Parker Christmas Charity Dinner. What charity did we support, or is this, I didn't realize we did that, so could somebody speak to that?
Dr. Jarrett?
If Mr. Lewis can't speak to the specifics, I guess I would suggest, if it's at all possible, to let us be able to track that stuff down prior to the board meeting. I don't know if you have any specifics on that, Mr. Lewis.
I don't have specifics, but I vaguely remember we can follow up. That the students that participated in the shopping for needy families, I think he provided meals for those students.
Okay.
But I'll follow up and get a specific answer.
Any other discussion or questions on item 8D? We'll call the roll on the approval of the purchase orders.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scribano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson? The motion passes unanimously.
I now need a motion and a second to approve consent item 9B, intergovernmental agreement with Rockford Park District.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Second by Dr. Harner. Any discussion or question? Mrs. McCulloch.
Yeah, I do. And we were presented a report on this at Ed Committee from last year and on the results achieved academically. But I have a couple of questions. This year we're adding special ed and
okay.
Well, I kind of want to get an understanding of this, how this intergovernmental agreement is working, what we did in the past and what we're doing now. So before last year, did we cooperate and have a cooperative agreement with the Park District to do our summer school class? Because this is a summer school, basically, right? And it's primarily Title I funds. There's a little bit of Fund 17 IDEA money because we have special ed students in there. And then we have a little bit of money from 21st Century for the farm town. So I want to understand if we're putting $549,000 in. What are we providing and what is the Park District providing?
This is the third year that we've had a collaborative with the Park District. It's also this Discovery Center is involved with it, the Arts Council. Basically, we provide the reading and math tutoring and instruction that occurs for grades K through 8. And the Park District provides the Fit for Life or health healthy living, I think. It's a rotation of 5 centers that the students go into. And they provide, the Discovery Center does some science exploration. That it all ties back into the reading and math that they're learning during their reading and math periods. It is for 1,800 students. Special education has always been a part of this initiative. It's the extended school year services that we offer to students as a requirement of their IEP, and we just integrate it with the rest of the summer school programs.
So since it's a reoccurring contract, is the amount about the same?
It's really less this year,
less this
I believe,
year, okay.
Yes.
And then my last question, and the results as I started my comments was that the results on the academics were very positive. Also, there was no disciplinary referrals. There were also all kinds of positive things, and I absolutely supportive. But I'm also supportive of the fact that we have, I don't know how the Park District staffs this program. We have a lot of peers in our district who work with us during the year and don't work in the summers, and there might be some continuity for students if those peers were continuing. So do we have any sort of agreement with the Park District that they will provide consideration for some sort of extra consideration for our staff members who might apply for the program since we're funding such a large portion of it? Or is that, are we just two separate entities and we supply teachers and where necessary for special ed, for example, paras? Do we have any of those conversations?
We do. We do have those conversations. The Park District and the school district, we often join them on the day that they're doing their interviews. Most of our paraprofessionals are the individuals that get hired through the Park District for the summer. My staff and myself collaborate with the Park District to try to ensure if we have a paraprofessional that worked with a particular group of children or a particular student that they're matched with that student for the summer. So it's very collaborative. The first year we did it, the Park District, and I think it was the Y, we had them hire the teachers and learned in that process that it's better for, so the district in years two and year three, we hire the certified staff and the Park District hires our support staff.
Awesome. Thank you. Those are all great answers, and I wanted to make sure everybody was aware of that. Thank you.
Any other questions or discussion on that topic? Ms. Jackson?
Yep, I do have one. Is there any way to get, I see under the several positive effects, like the data that supports it? For example, every grade level increased their academic performance in reading and math.
There was a presentation.
Oh, it'll be coming. It'll be coming to us in Ed Committee.
Attached to the board.
There was an attachment, but it gave the enrollment, the daily attendance rate, and it gave the proficiencies for the testing. And it specifically spoke about the increases. So in the 2013 year in reading, the students went from 34.2 to 41.2%. And in math, they went from 35.4% to 41.9%. And that was overall, it wasn't broken out by grade level.
Use the Discovery Ed assessment pre and post test, pre-program and then end of the summer.
Okay.
I apologize.
Sorry.
I just didn't go far enough. I thought I'd remembered seeing it. If you go all the way down, it is by grade level. There's K, first through seventh, it's all in that attachment. So my apologies, I was reading the overall. So it is there if you scroll down on page 8.
Okay, I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the approval of 9B, intergovernmental agreement with the Rockford Park District for Camp To the Future 2.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
I'll now take a motion and a second to approve the financial results.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Seconded by Dr. Harner. Questions and discussions? Mrs. Powers?
I guess it's more just a point for the budgeting process and moving forward. Our fill rate for open FTEs is higher than what it was last year, and that's a good thing, but we still were over budget And so the increased money from the state, general state aid offset that. So doesn't seem like it's that much of an issue, but I'm assuming that we're shooting for, I know we will never have 100% fill rate, but the goal is to have very few vacant FTEs. And if we're not budgeting for that, I don't see that there's necessarily an incentive to fill them, because then we're going to be over budget. So I guess I'm just wondering, from a process standpoint for next year's budget, and the fact that we are trying to have more compelling place to work with the work that our HR department's doing in the total rewards and compensation and all of that, there's a lot of things that are in place that hopefully we will have a better fill rate and fewer FTEs. So are we adjusting the budgeting process accordingly to not have a deficit?
Yes.
Okay.
Just to speak to the process, what we do is we're always working to have budgets as tight as we can, meaning that revenues are going to equal expenditures. So when we look at the staffing plan, we're staffing based on pupil teacher ratios throughout the continuum, pre-K through 12. It's children don't come in our neighborhoods or move in perfect little boxes and increments to meet our staffing plan. So we've committed to the neighborhood school concept. So if additional families move into a certain area, rather than place those children outside of the neighborhood as we used to, sometimes we have to create additional FTEs, fill those FTEs, which lends to a very fluid, but we kind of remain in the ballpark with our FTEs and our staffing patterns. But we are creating a budget for FY15 that'll be reflective of a few more FTEs, hopefully to mitigate some of this.
My question for you, Mr. Lewis, we're at the 6-month point now of in the fiscal year, and you give a wonderful summary in your report of where we're at. And I look at your summary, and it shows, you know, our expenses are higher, and you know, our income is always lacking, and timing is always an issue. And what I'd like to do, ask you basically, is, you know, where do you project us to be as of June 30th in actual to budget?
I think it's going to be a tight year. And I say tight because there's always the uncertainty with what our final categorical payments are going to be from the state. We did better than expected last year.
Right.
I'm expecting us to fall back one cat payment, and we're going to offset that by the increase to Mrs. Powell's point in general state aid, and we also are having an increase in CPPRT revenue. So I'm expecting it to be pretty tight this year.
Okay. Any other questions on the financial results? If not, I'll have the coordinator call the roll on the approval of item 10B, financial results.
Mrs. McCulloch?
Yes.
Dr. Harner?
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
We are now at the closed session consent agenda items, including the HR organizational report and addendum, and the closed session consent items of student discipline, in which the listed students are prohibited from being on school grounds and school-sponsored activities without the prior written permission of the principal, and suspensions are affirmed. The following students are expelled for the remainder of this school year, 2014, FME 18, JBS 32. The following students are expelled for the remainder of this school year and the first semester of next year, and that is students XD S24, AWC 27, MLM 28, CAP 29, TPK 34. The 10-day suspension has been upheld for the following student, CHR 33, and the following expulsions are held in abeyance contingent upon conditional probationary agreements, TSH 4, GS 16, ENL 20, TNB 25, MH 26, HLAD 30, CDM 31, and the following students have been granted a conditional probationary agreement. LB1, GE6, JMW7, JBW8, AGS9, MCY10, AT12, PTC13, and I don't think I need to list the ones that have been pulled. So is there a motion and a second to approve the closed session consent items?
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor.
Second.
Seconded by Ms. McCullough. Are there any items that board members would like to have pulled for separate consideration? Ms. Jackson.
12 all, 13 all.
12 and 13 all. Okay. I will have the coordinator then call the roll on the agenda items not pulled from closed session, which is basically number 11.
Dr. Herner.
Yes.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
Yes.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCullough?
Yes.
The motion passes unanimously.
I will do 12 and 13 together, Ms. Jackson. Is that okay with you? Okay, so I will now take a motion and a second to approve the closed session items under number 12 and number 13.
So moved.
Moved by Mr. Connor, seconded by Mr. Rollins. There is no discussion, so I'll have the coordinator call the roll.
Mr. Connor?
Yes.
Mrs. Powers?
Yes.
Ms. Jackson?
No.
Mr. Rollins?
Yes.
Mr. Scrivano?
Yes.
Mrs. McCullough?
Yes.
Dr. Herner?
Yes.
The motion passes with 6 yeses and 1 no.
The next item on our agenda is the superintendent's report, and I'll turn that over to Dr. Jarrett.
Thank you, Mr. Scrivano. The first item I'd like to spend a little time talking about is to take this opportunity to start on a more regular basis updating the board on the work we're doing in our facilities group that's chaired by Mrs. McCulloch, and also Dr. Herner is on the group as well. We have had 3 committee meetings. We have also had we are on 7 community collabs that have involved parents, students, teachers, and other community members. We've had a real intensive focus on looking at where we are in 2013 currently in terms of our footprint and in terms of the facilities we have, and we're contrasting that with what we would like to have as we target 2023 with a 10-year facility rollout, what that would look like. We're also spending a great deal of time focusing in the next phase here that we're moving into, looking at our current footprint and the specific educational adequacy and energy efficiency of our current buildings that we have, and looking for areas that we can improve. So we're going to be doing that kind of quantitative analysis, ultimately evaluating each building individually. Ultimately, this will lead to, within the next few months, I'm hoping by March or so, some really rough draft ideas about what the facility plan could look like. And this is very much not a linear process. That's one thing the DLR group that's facilitating is very clear about, that we will continue to go back and forth with sharing ideas and moving things as we build consensus in the community. I think one of the key components here is that we continue to have good representation from parents, students, staff, and the entire community. We recently had a really positive event on Saturday. We had about 35 attendees. The Community Input Committee did a wonderful job working with our Mr. Dotson and our team to have a really high, really good turnout of community members that we wanted to make sure were represented in the process. So we hope to have something that will come to the community back and forth as needed, and ultimately get back to the board in the summer after we've wrestled with these ideas over the course of the year, and encourage as much community involvement, staff involvement, parent student involvement as we can possibly have. There's going to be a lot more in terms of opportunities to do that. The other thing I would like to take a little bit of time to talk about is just had an amazing experience with we had the RAM organization, which has been supporting our students for 33 years with a scholarship event, and many prominent leaders in our community, including many of our school leaders, our former RAM scholars. They took their process to a new level this year by inviting last year's keynote speaker, Mr. Jeff Johnson, to speak to 2 groups of students, one at Guilford and one at Auburn, did an amazing job connecting with our students, not only during his keynote address at those schools, but also in the hallway afterwards. He also spoke to a group of donors that Mr. Dotson, Mr. Vosburg, and I had the chance to attend in the evening. We're really excited about the 33rd annual banquet that's coming up. The district is going to be getting at least one table for that event, and we'd love to encourage board members to see if you're available on the 21st. It's really an awesome night to celebrate scholarship and the achievement of our students. And again, it's really powerful to see when you look at that it was my first year attending last year, and when you look at what so many of the recipients of those scholarships come back to do in our community in terms of leading our community, but also leading many of our schools. It's really an awesome night. So I encourage the board, if you have availability, to find the opportunity to be part of that. It's a partnership that's continuing to grow and strengthen, and something I'm really passionate about.
Thank you. Mrs. McCulloch, you may proceed with the Education Committee report.
Education Committee has not met since the board has convened. We have our next meeting on February 3rd in this room at 5:30. We're going to attempt to make sure to make sure everybody understands that all the documents that support our community meetings do go online on the Friday before the meeting. So that would be this Friday, the 31st. And if anybody would like to look at those ahead of time, you just go to the website Board Docs, and they're listed under our library for the meeting of February 3rd. If you attend the meeting, we'll have cards at the in the vestibule giving you the link. And I was hoping in future meetings here, when this comes up and we give our committee report, we'll go ahead and put the link up on the screen so that anybody listening to the committee report that would like further information or more in depth can refer to those documents as well. So anybody who'd like to attend, the agenda and the documents will be online on Friday under Board Docs in the library.
Great. I think that'll be very helpful. Mr. Rollins, you can proceed with the Operations Committee report.
The Operations Committee has not met since our last board meeting, and we'll be meeting here in this room next Tuesday, February 4th at 5:30 p.m. We did not meet in January, so I expect we'll have a full agenda. Okay.
Ms. Ostergaard is here, and you're going to give us the Accountability Committee report. Thank you, Christine, for being here.
We have a clicker. Okay, so I'm Christina Ostergaard, and I'm the chairperson for the Accountability Committee. Thank you for asking me to come and give you an update. I was off the last 2 days with my kids and was making this presentation from memory at home. So I'm not really sure which version of this presentation you guys are going to get tonight.
Okay.
So we'll roll with it. So we're going to go through quickly through some different types of metrics that we've created over the last 2 years that the committee has been meeting. We've done building dashboards for the principals. We have helped set up department quality measures that the board has seen, I believe, for all of the functional departments. And I wanted to highlight a best practice in metrics that you received. I received when I was on the board. It's been a best practice, in my opinion, for probably the last decade right here in this school district. Also, I want to go over some of the value stream mapping events, the efficiency improvements that we put into place, and then go through some initiatives and proposals for regular reporting to the board. Okay, so for metrics, in 2013, I think I was here early in 2013, and I spoke to you about dashboards that we had started emailing to the principals at the beginning of the school year last year. So they were receiving metrics for each building based on discipline trends, truancy trends, just attendance in general, where the on discipline, where discipline's occurring, what time of the day, and what types of discipline. And we were encouraging principals at that time to use the data to implement interventions. and then come back to our committee and tell us how that was going. So we did that throughout the year. Also, at the beginning, I think during the summer, the departments got together with the accountability director and set up department metrics and measures that were going to be measured throughout the year. So they matched the district objectives that were put together, and so we have measures now in place for the departments on quality, efficiency, customer service, internal and external customers, literacy, and so on and so forth. So we looked at standards used throughout the country and tried to match those in our school district. And then we are also measuring against comparable districts, and the data that we're looking at comes from the Council of Greater City Schools. Okay, so then we've also looked at that now for three full quarters, and the fourth quarter we had some data. So we're able to see trends now, and as a committee, looking at trends and questioning the trends, good or bad. Okay, so this is where we diverge. So one of the best practices I wanted to highlight in the data that we're receiving in the performance measures, in the transportation department specifically, we have great data. Greg Wilson has been collecting data on miles, dollars per bus, trips per bus per day, and it's as coming from a data-driven job, this is great. The data he has is very clean, it's very good, and it's very positive. So just to let you know, he's got miles between accidents and that he's tracking, and miles between preventable accidents. So miles between accidents right now is at 43,971 miles. So that you have to think about that. In your car, can you go 44,000 miles without getting in a fender bender? So that's good. It's great. Okay, can you go miles between preventable accidents, 103,000 miles. So can you go 103,000 miles without getting in an accident that wasn't your fault? So think about that. And so those are great metrics. And when you put it into perspective, in driving your own car, how long it takes to rack up 103,000 miles, and if you can go without an accident, it just goes to show you the quality of the drivers in the transportation department. And I'd like to commend not only the drivers, but the data that shows that we have that quality. So, and just to give you an example, in aerospace where I work, we track miles or mean time between failures. So anytime you have to remove a part, how many hours between all of the airplanes flying in a certain fleet. And we target between 40,000 and 50,000 on a really good product line. So if you convert that into miles, he's right there where we would expect a best practice to be in aerospace. So good job in the transportation metrics. Okay, let's see. Okay, I'm missing a slide, so I'll just talk. In 2013, we did several efficiency events. We call these value stream mapping events in production in a production industry where we're trying to make processes more efficient. So in the district here, we looked first at professional development, and we went from a manual submittal of a request to take a class to an automated approval and payment. This enables us to automate the budgeting and financial allocation. So going into a class, you know how much as a district, you know how much it's going to cost you going into it. You know how many people have signed up. You can plan and budget accordingly, as opposed to waiting for an after-the-fact cost. So that's really good. And this has helped eliminate issues with double payments. So at the end of 2012, I believe that there was some instances where a class had been paid to a teacher. The reimbursement for a class had been paid twice. And we found that and had to reverse some of the payments. So completely automating the system eliminates that as an opportunity. We're also looking at the enrollment and registration process. So anyone who has enrolled a child in the schools know that this is there's a lot of paper to fill out. there's a lot of signatures, like almost as many as doing a home loan. So what's going on? So this value stream mapping event combines all of the registration paperwork into one packet. You do your signature one time. So your signature is covered on all of those with one signature. IDs are going to be printed prior to registration, so there won't be any waiting. And in the future state, I've even proposed that we go to electronic registration. So you can walk into a building to enroll your child, and you can type everything into a computer. You don't even have to fill out the papers. Okay, so the last one I want to talk about is textbook inventory. So this one's been talked about for a long time as well. I know we were talking about it in 2006. So it's linked to enrollment now. The improved process now counts as students are enrolled. It logs how many books you need. The sets are checked out by the teacher, and then they're passed out on day one. So you're not looking for books after school starts. So this has been piloted. It's already started in some middle schools and high schools, and we can report out on those improvements throughout the next year. Okay. Any questions? Keep going? Okay.
Yeah.
So 2014.
Of all those, the one that I know will reverberate the most with my constituents is the electronic. You know, being able to ease the whole registration process and streamline that. So you talked about conversations. So is there anything that we can expect for next year that they're talking about, or are those more long-term goals? Am I missing?
Are you talking about what the initiatives for next year or specifically associated with enrollment?
Specifically associated with registration process, such as signing a single form, such as being able to do it online, even, I don't know if we're even talking about distally or you have to do it in-house, specifically about having the IDs ready ahead of time. Are those all just proposals? I'm just trying to understand, are those expectations for next year?
I'll let Mr. Wiestman answer.
So some of those we are implementing in some of the schools. There are a couple of high schools and middle schools that are going to try having, for example, IDs ready for the kids when they get there so they don't have to stand in line and wait for the IDs. Fred Deal's helping us on that with the security end. The single sign pages we're working through right now, and we'll hopefully have something for all of the buildings for that version for the elementary, middle, and high schools for that. The online registration portion is further out. That we can't really do that this year. It's not this year.
That's my ideal state. I added that myself.
Well, was that an online only in the building or remote as well?
Both.
Both, okay. Okay, well, people will look forward to all those.
Okay, so some of the initiatives we'd like to be a part of and trend for 2014, reviewing the department metrics quarterly. So each department worked with the Director of Accountability, with Mr. Wiestman, to develop metrics for their department. It was being done in parallel with the transitioning of the superintendents and creating the board objectives. So what we're envisioning is that we'll audit all of these metrics that are in place now and link them back to the objectives of the superintendent, the district, and the board, and make sure that there's a hard link to all of the objectives so that the departments know that what they're doing is directly impacting one of the objectives for the district. And then we also want to monitor the trends. So again, the customer satisfaction, are your teachers happy? Are your students happy? Are there issues affecting them that we can improve? Are your external customers happy? Is the community getting what they want, what they expect? Are your parents happy? And then just looking at the efficiencies that we've identified and see how they're trending. There's action plans for all of these value stream mapping events. And once the actions are implemented, are they trending in the right direction? We're always talking about have surveys again. The committee touches on this probably once a quarter and determines whether or not we want to look into doing a survey. If there's a survey going on, do we have the opportunity to add our own types of questions to track responses? So we'll continue to touch base on surveys. And then finally, pathway metrics. So we're implementing the pathways at the high school. Are there any types of tracking, trending that we want to do? We've got the freshman class started at Jefferson. It's the perfect time to start tracking stuff. So in 4 years, we'll have very good data to see what the effects of the pathways are. One last late-breaking thing that happened that we discussed briefly as I was walking in here is IT planning and initiatives. There's discussions going on about improvements that can be made in IT. Do we want to track any of that as improvements are being made? Okay, so here's my proposal for reporting. So it's been about a year, I think, since you got a report out from me. It's, for me, I'm just rolling with it, rolling with what we're doing and excited that we're making a lot of progress, and I forget that you guys don't always know what we're doing, so I apologize. But I'm gonna propose that we start reporting quarterly as a committee to both the operations committee and the ed committee. So whatever, any improvements that we're making on spending or efficiencies or recommendations, we would go to the ops committee and report that out. And then any of the key indicators for education, we can report those to the ed committee. And then you will be able to discuss here regularly if there's anything that needs to be discussed at the board level. So, okay, that's everything I had. Are there any questions?
When the value stream mapping has, I think you did one in purchasing too, didn't we? At one time,
yeah,
do that
we did one?
One
in 2012.
Yeah, how do you prioritize the opportunities to apply that?
I mean, how do we choose which projects?
Right.
You want to answer?
So on an annual basis, our director of research and evaluation, as they go through the planning, the annual planning process with the departments choose a improvement process that they would like to really attack for that year that would be useful in that, and then we really just kind of look at the calendar and figure out where will they fit in the calendar and with the ebb and flow of everything going on in the district.
Okay. Ms. Powers.
So I'm assuming, Mr. Wiesman, that before we would pursue any online registration, there would be a business case for that?
Yes, that's
the main reason. Many of our parents don't have access, and
right.
So I get that we want to streamline it as much as we can, but if it's cost prohibitive for what may be a small amount, I guess we all have smartphones, we all think that's the way to do it. Many of our parents, that's not. And I think that as long as we are also trying to encourage parents to connect with their schools, if we can do something when they get there to streamline it and make it inviting and welcoming to the school, a lot of times that's the first time parents are going through the building, they get to see principals and teachers, and I think we need to be careful about how much we would put into an online enrollment.
And to validate what you're saying, Ms. Powers, one of the great things about a value stream mapping event is that it's not really me making the decisions at the table. You get we had a group of clerical, assistant principals, other staff members there that are part of this, and they really said, you know, we use registration for a lot more than just gathering information. And so the event really focused on how can we make the current process where people come to the school better. That's what it ended up focusing on. And then as a future investigation, we've got on our list of things to do is investigate online enrollment.
Okay. And so the other thing that was talked about was surveys. And I think that just like we sometimes over-assess our kids, I think we can over-survey. And so being cognizant of how we get that
Definitely.
Feedback, I think, is a great thing. So
Definitely.
Thank you.
I agree.
And by the way, you get even less recognition than the board members do on this volunteer
yes.
position. So thank you very much for
thank
what you.
You
do, Christy.
Thank you.
I was going to kind of ask a question related to that is, you know, how is the participation and attendance at meetings that you're having and things like that?
So the participation at a committee level has dwindled. We have about, I would say, six of our 10 members attending regularly still. One moved away. And I was going to come and ask for approval to reduce our official number because we're not always, most of the time we don't have a quorum. But as I thought about it, we don't actually vote on anything. We just make recommendations and we look at trends. And so we don't need a voting, we don't need a quorum as long as we have good discussions and we're continuing to move forward. So as long as everyone's okay with that, that's how we're gonna keep rolling. And then I did put out feelers to see if there were people that were interested in joining. Again, I didn't think at the time that we needed to add, we didn't need to add more people because the core group that we have is really doing a lot of, we're meeting at our regularly scheduled times and we're getting through the information we wanna see. So I'm happy with it.
Okay. Good. Any other questions for Christina? Ms. Jackson.
What work are you doing with the expulsion packets and the discipline referrals? You might have spoke to that and I missed it.
Oh, so yeah, we're not actually, well, there was a VSM event that the district held to streamline the process of putting it together, putting the packets together. So you want to talk to that as well?
Right, so there were two main outcomes of that. The first is that teachers have the option now of writing a discipline referral for a student through the SunGuard suite online, through their teacher access center. They still can do a paper copy, but they have the option to do an online copy. That streamlines the process for many people, specifically the teachers and the assistant principals. It saves them time walking and paper and transferring and double entering of information. The second big thing that came out of that was the expulsion packets. I know in the last 6 to 8 months, maybe about 6 to 8 months ago, the format's different. Much of that is automated. And so that process in of itself, they look different now than they did 8 to 9 months ago. And that is because much of that is being automated from the SunGuard system.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you for your service to the district.
Thank you.
All right. We do not have any action items for tonight's meeting, so we are now on to the new and other business. Ms. Cyrus, are you going to make this presentation on the Rockford Arts and Education Grant Evaluation Agreement?
So, good evening. Before you tonight, we have a contractor, a consulting contract for an evaluator. Earlier in the year, the district wrote and received a grant for $1,180,000 to infuse arts into the math curriculum. And as a component of that, that grant, a required element of it is to have an outside evaluator to complete an annual report and submit that to the department, U.S. Department of Education. So that is what this particular contract is for, is to have the University of Illinois Rockford to be the evaluator for that grant.
Okay. Any questions or discussion on that, Mr. Connor?
One question. In the Appendix A consulting services, there's a lot of steps regarding data collection strategies, analyze, and there's a whole bunch of data types. And it also says for each site, enter data for attendance, so on and so forth. So perhaps this question is more for Mr. Wiesman, but do I assume that these are new techniques that we're going to need to develop, or are there standard data collection techniques that this group already has in place? For example, data importing into their system, or is this something that we need to develop out of this?
I actually don't know that.
Okay. I think what I'd ask is, because I have no problem with the program, the program's great. I don't even have a problem with their analysis. I think I just want to make sure that the data collection techniques, there might be some assumptions written into this, and all I'd like is somebody to look into it, so that we don't have either redundant steps being done inside this grant that we need to do as a district, for example, and that any assumptions of data export to any system they have, I just want to make sure we know about that, what the conditions are of getting data. And the last is that if there are reports, and it looks like there's a lot of reports, typically there might be a data export that we would want for our own long-term analysis. So I would just want to make sure that that's written into the contract. And I'm happy to help with wording on that, but I'd at least like to suggest we look into those techniques.
Okay.
Any other questions or discussion on this topic? Okay, thank you. Are there any additional new business items or agenda recommendations? Ms. Jackson.
Actually, no, but I do have something before we go, and it's on the CAM to the Future that we talked about. Can you tell me, who is the staff that works there? It's Rockford Public School teachers that do the classrooms? Because I know that it said there was an increase, I believe, in reading and math, but when you look at page 7, it talks about the students in my group improved in reading, the students in my group improved in math, and the lesson plans were easy to use. The red and blue are almost equal in that area. So is that something that we can look at?
So are you looking at the data that, or are you looking at the surveys that
were? I'm looking at the staff responses to the survey.
Sure, certainly we can look at that.
Okay, and I'll just send you an email to kind of outline, but it seems that the red and blue are really close on that.
And when you send them email, can you make sure you put Dr. Wolf on the email?
Only you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Are there any other new business items?
So moved.
Ready to adjourn?
Second.
All right, we have a motion to adjourn. Ms. Connor, second by Ms. Jackson. Not bad, an hour and 2 minutes.